Per extra, this is published just few months before Nundija. Okay, thank you very much. Next.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Ghosh, please.
Good afternoon, my respected teachers and my dear colleagues. Now I'm going to present an interesting case, an encounter of therapeutic dilemma during primary PCI. A 45 years old male patient, non-diabetic and smoker, presented with history of typical angina of 4 hours duration. On examination, patient had tachycardia, patient had hypotension with blood pressure of 94/60 mmHg. Cardiovascular system examination was normal without any murmur, chest was clear. ECG-wise, there was acute anterior LMI. Echo-wise, there was anterior wall hypokinesia with preserved thickness with LVEF of 38%. So planned for primary PCI. In coronary angiogram, in left shoot, we can see there is proximal total occlusion of LAD and there was no significant flow limiting lesion of left circumflex. And in right shoot, we can see a dominant RCA was seen arising from the right coronary sinus. And one second vessel is originated from the proximal RCA. The patient had severe chest pain. Patient developed hypotension as well. And patient was started on inotropes. So that's why we immediately planned for primary PCI to LAD. This is in left shoot. We can see that 0.014 inches galio wire was introduced into LAD. And pre-dilatation was done with 1.25 into 10 millimeter balloon at 6 atmosphere of pressure. After pre-dilatation, some flow was established into LAD. But the challenges in front were, first is the LAD that we got after pre-dilatation was a diminutive vessel and it was extending to only AV group with one diagonal and it was diseased. And the treated LAD didn't reach the apex. Patient also had ongoing chest pain in spite of the flow into LAD, and there was persistent ST changes, ST elevation in the ECG, and the hypotension was persisted. So we planned to recheck the angio, and we reviewed the angio. In the right shoot, we have seen one second vessel was originated from the proximal RCA, and that vessel showed a distal 95% stenosis. So we thought it can be a dual LAD and a type 4 LAD, dual LAD. So the final review angiography findings of my case was left main artery giving rise to a diminutive LAD terminated in the proximal part of the interventricular groove after giving rise to D1, a large dominant RCA arising normally from the right coronary sinus, and a second vessel originated from the proximal RCA, that is a long LAD with distal 95% lesion, and that was a dual LAD type 4. So in view of ongoing chest pain and persistent ECG changes, the plan was to address the lesion of the long LAD, the dual LAD, that is the distal 95% stenosis. So 0.014 galio wire was introduced into the long LAD and it was pre-dilated with 2 into 10 millimeter of Maverick semi-compliant balloon. After pre-dilatation, there was flow was established in the long LAD and the chest pain was reduced, patient became clinically better and the ECG changes also improved. So finally, 2.5 into 18 millimeter drug eluting stent was this deployed at 8 atmosphere of pressure in the long LAD. And after that, post dilatation was done using 2.5 into 10 millimeter non-compliant sphincter balloon at 10 atmosphere of pressure. So this is the final result of our case. So finally, we were happy. This is the spinal pharyngeal classification of dual LAD. In type 1, the short LAD will give rise to only major proximal septals and the long LAD will traverse from the left ventricular side of anterior interventricular septum. In case of type 2, the short LAD will be the same, the long LAD will traverse from the right ventricular side of anterior interventricular septum. In type 3, the short LAD again will be the same and the long LAD will have a intramyocardial course. But type 4 is very rare also and it is different from other three types because here in the short LAD that will give both major septal perforators as well as the diagonal branches and the long LAD will come from the RCA as in our case. To summarize, dual left anterior descending artery is a very rare inherited anomaly and variants of dual LED pattern are found in around 0.13 to 1%. Type 4 dual LED is a very rare list in anomaly, and it was first description was given in 1939 by Watterson et al. Take home message for my cases: coronary anomalies can be incidentally revealed during primary PCI and may produce difficulties in detecting and treating the culprit lesion. Correct interpretation of symptoms and ECG are helpful in detection and treatment of the culprit lesion in cases with dual LED as in our patient. Thank you.
Gosra Chaudhry, please. Excellent presentation. Any question? Any question from the floor, if any?
In the initial angiogram, you have not shown the heart's RAO view.
Yes, sir.
That would have made very clear that the patient is having this LED, the large LED.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you very much. Next, Dr. Gupta is there? Okay. So there is a reverse wire technique. So, PGI Chandigarh.
Good evening, everyone. I'm going to show an interesting case of PCI using a reverse wire technique. Our patient was a 67-year-old male who was a diabetic and hypertensive, and he had a history of PCI done to mid LED with a diagnostic stent in May to, in September 2005, and also a PCI to mid RCA in May 2007. Now he had presented with a history of angina for 3 months with a positive stress echo with regional wall muscle abnormality in the infiltrator segments and with normal resting ejection fraction. His initial coronary angiogram had shown a patent stent in the LED and a mid RCA 50% ISR and a tight bifurcation disease at the crux at the in RCA. And there was a tight disease, significant 90% stenosis in the proximal LCX. This was an again, initial angiogram with the LO caudal view showing an angulated proximal LCX with obtuse angle takeoff. And the same region can be seen in the RAO caudal view also. This is the LO caudal view showing the angulated takeoff of the LCX with a stenosis in the proximal LCX. And in the RAO caudal view also, we can appreciate the stenosis in the proximal LCX. So we went with the initial wiring using a filter wire and also a run-through wire, but we were not able to wire the LCX because of the angulated course of the LCX. These are the videos showing the initial unsuccessful attempts of initial wiring. Then a wiring attempt was done through a crusade catheter with a wiring of the LCX through the side hole of the crusade catheter. As you know, a crusade catheter is a catheter with both end and side holes. So with the through the end hole, we had put a wire in the main in the OM1, and through the side hole, we tried wiring the LCX. But again, this was also unsuccessful. This is showing the crusade catheter with wire in the OM1 from the front port and a second wire pointing to the LCX from the side port. However, we were not able to cross through the side hole. And so to summarize, initially the techniques we used were we thought of doing the LCX lesion first because it was the most difficult lesion and also it was the most significant lesion. And via a right 6 French right radial axis, we went ahead with the PCI to LCX. But we made various attempts using a fine cross with filter and filter electricity wires with a crusade wire with a filter and run through wires. Crucial character, and also we tried a balloon occlusion of OM1 to direct the wire into LCX. However, this was not successful. And then we also use a larger curves of guide up to XB3, 3.5 and 4 but to of for selective hooking of the LCX, but again this was not successful. Then we thought of going ahead with this technique of a reverse wire technique in which a crucial character is used through the end hole. The main branch is wired first, and then wire is reversed on itself, taking a 180 degree turn, and then it is made to prolapse in the side branch. So this was the technique we used. Here we can see the crusade catheter in the OM branch, and here the wire is allowed to prolapse in the side branch as we pull the crusade backwards. Using a crusade with 180 degree curve of the side port wire, we went ahead with the first wiring of the OM1, and then crusade was advanced and then pulled back so that the side wire collapses into the side branch. So this was successful, and we went ahead with the anchoring of the balloon in OM1 to get a support, and then exchanged the crewset with a fine cross and for a grand slam wire for extra support. And we went ahead with the pre-dilatation with 2.5 mm balloon, and then with the PCI2 LCX with synergy standoff 2.5 into 16 and PCI2 OM with a synergy of 2.5 into 20. And this was a final image showing the PCI2 LCX and PCI2 OM1. And then again, while standing the LCX, we also ballooned the OM1 so to prevent stent overhang. So this was the final result showing well expanded stents, and the final result can be seen in this scene. So the take-home message is reverse wire technique was first reported by Kawasaki and Calix in 2008. It is an extremely useful procedure in difficult bifurcation lesions, and particularly in obtuse angle lesions with more than 150 degrees of angle, and where the conventional techniques of wiring are not possible or they have failed. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Excellent presentation. So any question from?
This technique we can practice by doing it on RCNA. Every time we used to forget about the RV branch.
Yes.
If you want to save the RV branch, you can apply this, so you can be expertised,
yes,
by doing it on the cases of RV.
Thank you. Okay. Pankaj is there? Pankaj, please come. So Pankaj from the Mercure Medicity Hospital, and he will present the novel multimodality use of thromboaspiration catheter as a part of pharmacoinvasive strategy during the primary PCI in case of coronary ectasia.
Thank you, sir, respected teacher, moderators. Thank you, NIC, for giving me the opportunity. I'm presenting a case of primary angioplasty where a 38-year-old male presented with complaints of chest pain of 2 hours duration, and he had ST elevations in anterior leads and also in inferior leads. Echocardiography showed hypokinesia of distal IVS, apex, apical and mid-anterior segments with ejection fraction of 50%. So patient was actually a smoker, and also simultaneously he was chewing gutkha also. So large amount of intake of tobacco must have made his artery very ectatic, and there was big ectasia of the, and you can see the contrast which was staying, and this primary angioplasty doing in such ectatic coronary artery is really a tough time. So I started using initially Fielder FC wire, but wire was not going beyond the ectatic segment. It was revolving inside, and it was not possible. So what I thought is better to give some kind of pharmacological therapy. So I injected using thromboaspiration catheter, which to deliver the intracoronary tenecteplase plays around 10 milligrams using 6 French export thromboaspiration catheter over the Fielder FC wire, which was present already, which I present. And then after that, when I injected through the microcatheter, I could see some contrast and some further course of the LAD. I could see down faint flow in the LAD with TME1 flow was seen. So with the help of thromboaspiration catheter, which was present already there, I could pass the wire, which was a Fielder FC wire, further down into the LAD. And with the same thromboaspiration catheter, I did the thromboaspiration also. So thromboaspiration catheter, I could use in a multimodality manner for the injection of the drug. And then I deployed the short segment lesion, which was there, using 3x24 millimeter drug eluting stent. And the proximal part of the stent, as it was little bigger, I did the part that is optimization technique using 4x10 non-compliant balloon. So this was the final result. There was some sluggish flow was there, but which improved further by giving sodium nitroprusside intracoronary, and it established a TME3 flow. So take home message is, in a patients of coronary artery ectasia, Sometimes you can encounter while doing primary angioplasty, we have to adopt some different strategy, because your regular strategy of using simple wire and balloon may not work. So you have to use multidisciplinary sequential dethrombosis strategies, where you have to use pharmacological and mechanical invasive methods. And as the pathophysiology of this patient has a diffuse ectasia of coronary artery, we need to restratify them, and future management has to be decided. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Pankaj. Have you aspirated the clot?
Pardon?
Prior to the infusion of the tenecteplase place, have you tried to aspirate the clot?
No, because I was not able to cross my wire.
Okay.
So after giving tenecteplase place only, I could see the distal part of the LAD. So usually in ectasia, there is a large burden of the thrombus. So my wire was just rotating inside, it was not crossing, and I don't know where to go. So after giving tenecteplase, I could see some portion of the LAD, and then I could cross the wire, and then I could thromboaspirate
it. But from the angiogram, it looked like that the real lesion was distal.
Yeah.
The proximal part was ectatic.
Yes.
Actually, that was the reason that probably because of the band, the wire was not going.
Yeah.
Even
though if it is a normal size vessel, even if it is a bend, you can pass. But whatever force I was trying to pass the wire, it was rotating, and there was no further advancement of the wire. So that was my problem.
Pankaj, this case is particularly ectasia containing huge clot thrombi. So that case, you know, many people advocate the defer angioplasty. Give the thrombolytic and then wait a couple of hours, 3 to 16 hours. Next day morning you can do this clot. Otherwise, put this stent, chance of rethrombosis must be there.
Actually, so I also is well validated point, sir. But actually, my lesion was in an area where there was no ectasia, so it was a tapering portion of the ectasia where artery was really becoming little normal size. So I thought that better to put the stent. And patient is doing well. He has almost completed 1 year follow.
As you put the stent over the thrombus, chance of there is no and thrombus is there.
Yeah, that
okay,
is.
Okay, now you're successful. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.